please stand up, make some noise, and give a big welcome to our two athlete role models, Sergey Bubka and Yelena Isinbaeva. All right, once again, a good evening to everyone, ladies and gentlemen. We hope you are enjoying your time here so far at the Youth Olympic Village.
That introduction was enough.
Yeah, we're here at the Youth Olympic Village, Lecture Theatre 1. We're having our chat with champions, with Yelena Isinbaeva and Sergey Bubka. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, a big welcome to both of them. We'd also like to say a big hello to our audiences watching from all over the world, over the internet. Here we are going to talk about getting on top. That is the theme for our dialogue today. Between the both of them, they have almost 60 world records. And today we'll be finding out how they made their journey. Now, before we go any further, we have a short presentation for both of them. We'll start, of course, with ladies first. Sergey, I hope you don't mind. Yelena Isinbaeva. We have a short presentation. Of course, all of you know this. She is a double Olympic Games gold medalist, and she was the first female to cross the 5-meter pole vault mark. And indeed, a historic achievement. She was also the female athlete of the year in 2004, 2005, and 2008. And she was given the Laureans Women Sportswoman of the Year award twice in a row. But you know, all of this says nothing about her achievements, so we'll need a little video presentation to show us about her Olympic moment. Take a look, everybody.
Amazing. And that's just one of her many records that she's broken. That was in Beijing 2008, just 2 years ago. I can't even do that somersault. All right. And right now, we shall be talking about Mr. Sergey Bubka. He is, of course, yes, Mr. Sergey Bubka. He too is a 3-time Olympian. He bagged his gold medal in the Olympics back in Seoul in 1988. And he has set the first, he set his first world record at the age of 21 years old. A world record at 21 years old. And he has broken the men's world record 35 times. Round of applause for that. 35 broken world records.
May
and he sets
correction. Because it's not 3 times Olympian, 4 times, sorry.
Whoa.
88, 92, 96,
2000. Oh, 4-time Olympian. Our mistake, it's been 4 times already. And of course, his record of 6.14 meters has been standing for 16 years. His world record is still there since 1994. And the 6-time gold medalist at the IAAF World Championships. And he himself, one man, has cleared the 6-meter mark in 49 competitions. That is more than all of the other pole vaulters who have cleared 6 meters. Wow. Let's have a visual presentation of Mr. Sergey Bubka. That was his jump at the Seoul 1988 Olympics. The the simultaneous interpretation right now, so if you guys have any questions later, you know, it'll be very easy for them.
Okay, so we'll move on to our very first question of this evening. Now, Yelena and Sergey, the two of you have known each other for quite a while now. You know, Yelena told me that you met in about 2002, is that right?
Yes, officially, yes.
Officially. Could you tell us more about how the two of you met?
Well, I could start. So I see first time Sergey Bubka in Sydney when it was Olympic Games in 2000. And I was just 18 years old, so my performance was really bad. I didn't qualify there, but I saw so many stars there. They was inspiring me a lot. And when I, when I lost qualification, we was walking outside with a friend of mine. And then we passed through Sergey, and she said, "Oh, did you see?" I say, "What happens? Did you see Sergey Bubka?" I say, "No, where he is? Just behind." I was, "Oh my God." And I, of course, my camera was always with me, and was, "How can I go now and ask for the picture?" She was, "Just run for him, and he will let you do." "Oh no, maybe not. I don't want to be, you know, in such position when he would say no." "Okay, let's try. I was running for him, and he was just going, you know, relaxing alone. It was evening time, and I just make a round around him, running around him, say, "Oh, hello, Mr. Bubka, I'm also pole vaulter. I do training, my personal best, blah, 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 and can I make picture with you?" And he was like, "Yes, and was in the village. And can I make picture with you?" And he just, you know, relaxed and called him, "Yes, of course." And I was, "Yes!" and that was my first time. And then officially he congratulate me with my first adult medal. It was in Munich 2002 when I was second in the European Championship. So, yes, there we meet, like, my coach, present myself to Sergey. Sergey shake my hand. So it's also...
Sergey, do you have any memories of that moment?
Yeah, when Yelena met me in 2000 in Sydney, I was on duty and I came to the village. It was some evening time, and of course, I didn't remember that I did that photo because I was very tired, and Yelena remembered this. But I remember when I met her in 2002 in the European Championships, when she got her silver medal. And that time we talk, and I see it's good and great potential for future.
All right, Sergey and Yelena, we've talked about how you guys have met. Let's talk about a bit of the world records that you guys have set so far. Yelena, maybe we start with you. After your jump in Beijing, 5.06 meters, you're currently taking a break from pole vaulting?
No, I was jumping all 2009. And I just take break this summer, 2010 summer, because after such a great achievements, I realized that I have to rest a little bit for the...
Right.
Future greatest achievements, because there is a London Games 2012, there is two championships, world championships in Daegu in Moscow. So I must be fresh mentally, physically for such important competition, and just to retire it with 100% satisfaction, if I could say like this.
Right, you're just talking about the Olympics in 2012. How far do you think you can go in 2012?
You mean how high?
Yes, how high you can go.
How high I can go? Well, I don't know, as high as possible, but I'm sorry, the young pole vaulters here, but I wish to set up some vault records which will never beaten, how can I say, by beat, which will remaining forever.
Wow, she hopes to set world records that no one here can beat. How about that?
Yeah, but you know what, but for sure, this Youth Olympic Games will open a new start, a new great champions. I'm completely sure about that. And maybe here is already some very ambitious girls which will try to beat world records anyway. So I'm really sure about that. So.
Very cool. And Sergey, of course, we mentioned your current world record, which has been standing for 16 years. Do you think you could have jumped higher than 6.14 meters?
You mean for younger generation?
For yourself? Do you think if you were still competing then, would you have beaten your own record of 6.14?
No, when I competed, when I started, I didn't expect that it will be 6 meters or 6 meter 14 out of world record. And when I did these results over 6 meters, I dream to jump 6:20 because I thought 6:20 can remain longer. But 6:14, I thought it's not enough. It was my personal feelings and impression. But still is 16 years. I think it is not so high. It's good chance to jump higher for sure, because in my best worlds, when the scientists analyzed and they said it's some attempt was 6:37, 6:34, it means the young generation can jump higher. It's don't worry about the record. For me also was when I started, when I grew, it was difficult to believe. I dream, it was not easy, for sure. You need to put a lot of efforts, a lot of energy. But it's most important, you need to focus and work hard. This is will bring you success. And never give up. It can be difficult moments. But continue to work, and results, it's improving. It's getting better. And of course, for me also, this 6:14 was difficult to imagine. But when you achieve some goal, when you dream about something, when you achieve, don't stop. You can celebrate, you can enjoy, but next morning, start from scratch. In this way, you can be the better. You can break 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Everything is possible. Everything in your hands.
Some very, very wise words for all of us here.
I think we have time to go for questions from the audience right now. Does anyone have any question for either Yelena or Sergey?
Yep, just raise your hands in the air and our mic assistants will come to you.
Ah, we have one over there, the lady right in the middle. Yes, she has a question.
Okay, please do stand up, state your name, NOC and your sport before putting forward your question.
Spanish or English? Okay. I'm Sol Eskenazi, I play tennis. I'm from Argentina, and I would like to know how much time did you train before you broke these records?
For me, it takes, my first record was in 2003. Before, I spent 10 years in gymnastics. When I was 5 till 15, I did gymnastics. From 15 till how old I was? 19.
It's been a long time.
2000, I was 18. 2019. 2000. Okay. No, in 2004 I was 22. So 2003 I was 23. Yes. Wow. Okay. So. Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm a little bit nervous. Well, I was since 15 till 21, it's 6 years. For me, it takes 6 years. Yeah. But in between, I did junior record, so like this. I'm
sorry. Sergey, would you like to answer that question? How long did you train to reach where you were? Or was it a training all the way?
Well, in different age, it's different training for sure. When I started, maybe 2 times per week, because I started when I was 10 years old. And after 9 years, I become world champion in pole vault, in athletics. There's no one expect. I didn't expect to, because my coach planned my career to be in starting the top from 20 years old, when I arrived in age of 20. It means in 1984. But that time, it was boycott of Olympic Games, I didn't compete. But when I, until 18, it was more careful, sometimes 2 times, sometimes 1 time, because I went to normal school. I combined sport and education same time. I finished school with very good results. It was never a problem with me. Even I left the family when I was 15. And of course, after 18 years old, I start to practice 2 times per day. It can be 2 days, 2 times, 1 day, one training, and after day off, and something in this routine. But of course, it's everything depends on the coach. But in any way, you need to work hard. This is for sure. In particular, you said you are from tennis, yes? I like tennis very much. It's a beautiful sport. But in tennis, you practice, I don't know, what, 3 times? Yeah, you train a lot. You play, you train. This is also nice, beautiful sport. Each sport has something special, but you are working hard. It's not easy, and competition always, it's very tough. Work hard, you will be the best for sure.
Work hard and you will be the best. Definitely words to remember. Shall we have another question from the floor? Anyone? Okay, the gentleman over there in white. Just give us a moment. Our mic assistant will come to you.
Once again, name, NOC, and the sport that you play.
Good evening. I'm the young ambassador from China. I would like to ask a question for my athlete. This girl is our pole vault athlete for this competition. And she would like to ask both of you that what do you think is the key point of pole vault? Thank you.
Something.
No, I think I Yelena wants to give the floor to me. Okay, I will. No, the pole vault is very technical, very good event, but very complicated because it's two sports combined. On the ground, it is athletics. After takeoff, it's artistic gymnastic. And of course, many components needs to be. You must be very fast. You must be good gymnast. You need to have strength, mental stability because you compete in many hours and bar always rising. It's always pressure from opponent. It's not direct pressure from your opponent, but psychologically you need to survive in different condition. In the moment you are leading, your opponent jump higher, you are down, but you need to continue. The most important, I would say, of course, it's technical skills. Because many kids and many athletes, they are good physically, but they can miss technique. If you not do technically well, you can face the problem. The most important part, which I consider the key point, for my performance, for my success, and the difference between my performance and my opponents, this is transforming the pole from the ground, from runway, to penetrate and do the takeoff properly well. That pole can get movement, can get power. This is the key point of pole vault. If you do this part very well, it's different for sure, 20, 30 centimeters in your performance, in your results will be higher.
Yeah, I could say that you must have had fun and enjoy competition.
Having fun is very, very important as well. Okay, shall we have a next question from our audience? The young lady here in black?
Yes, you.
Yes.
Once again, name, NOC, and which sport you play?
I'm Reed Hancock from the United States, and I pole vault. And I was wondering, what's the biggest challenge you've ever overcome from pole vaulting?
Yes, she wants to know the biggest challenge you've overcome in your pole vaulting career.
Что я жертвовал, да? Или как?
Какие трудности ты испытывал в процессе своей спортивной карьеры? Самый трудный момент.
Самый. Okay. I think the most difficult challenge it was the injury, which was sometimes in which happened sometimes, but it was always hard to overcome, or how can I say? And also during the competition. when I do have like third attempt, it's also was always hard to be always in the line. Oh, I win or I lose. So that was also hard. But every time when I won the competition in such a difficult from such a difficult situation, I feel always happy. So and maybe another challenge, or I could say this test sacrifices. Yeah, sacrifices. Mm-hmm. Sacrifices because all. My young girl's life, I sacrifice a lot to achieve such achievements in sport. And for all of you, it's you also must have do it. So you will sacrifice a lot. You will how can I say, you won't live normal life like your friends will live, I mean, outside of sport. So this is also quite a kind of challenge. Okay.
No, I just want to add to Yelena's comment regarding certain sacrifice you need to go through. Of course, your life and comparison to your friends, your colleagues who is not doing sport, for sure is different. And I know what you are facing. You want to go to disco, you want to eat everything what you want, but don't worry about that. Sport career is not long. You will get all this excitement, all this pleasure time, a lot in your future. But when you focus to sport, to achieve the goal, this is most important, to be successful, to beat your weak parts. Because every one of us has challenges. For myself, from 12 years old, I was very strict with diet, with my food diet. In 16 years old, I couldn't believe how possible to compete until 25 years old. Because I was really tough, really strict with water, with everything what I had. And of course, later on, I found that the best way, I found how to manage, and I finished my career when I was 36 years old. It means I don't have any regrets that I lost something. What I got everything from sport. Sport opened me door to the world, to discover the world, to meet a lot of great friends. You have this great opportunity today. And after the end of my career, I was lucky to be elected to IOC Athletes Commission. In 1999, to become first active athletes who become IOC member. And now I'm working for sport. This is best what I can dream. To serve you, do the best, to help to move Olympic movement forward. This is like my dream comes true. Another challenge, which I would say, in 1996, I got injury a couple months before Olympic Games in Atlanta. And I managed with injury until the Olympics. And after Olympics, I planned to stop. But my tendon was already tear 25%. And when I came to the final, in qualification, I couldn't run. It's my tendon, it's grow in double comparison to normal condition. I couldn't resist any more pain. And I couldn't consider that it was give up. I didn't have any chance to compete. If I push to run, next day doctor said you can crush your tendon completely. And it was difficult time to recover without surgery. In the end, in December, I tried to avoid surgery, but in December I did test again and the doctor said surgery. And 8 months later after surgery, I would say without really small preparation, because 3 months I couldn't train at all. I couldn't do jogging. After 3 months, I did some small jogging, start to practice, but my shape before world championships, before my sixth title, was not good. I was on the edge to go to championships or not. In the end, I decided to go. And I had also good motivation because my opponents start to say, Bubka doesn't have courage and power to stop career. He go to the championships with very poor results because I had results before world championships, 5 meters, 61 centimeters, when my record was 6'14". And it's no one believe that I can manage something. But I was motivated to prove to my opponents that I'm alive. And I would say it was in some way mission impossible to win that championships. But it was only willpower which pushed me to do my best. And I clear 6 meters, 1 centimeters. And that attempt, I would say maybe if 6'40 was on the top, on the bar, I will clear for sure. Because I want to be winner. I don't want to be loser. I want to be the best. And it's happened. This was very big challenge, which I managed, I would say, with incredible, strong effort, I would say, just mentally I survive and I want to be the best. And this was great challenge, and I wish you to overcome the challenges, because challenges start every day. What time you wake up? 6, 7, or 8? Do you do the training before school or before university? This is up to you. This is challenge. Be the champion. Come over challenges, and you will discover the world, and you will be on the top of this world. I wish you good luck.
Very inspirational indeed. Yes, we have time for some questions. Yes, young man in blue, I think he is from Ukraine. Can we have a question from him?
Всем добрый вечер. Я з України. Меня зовут Роман. Я занимаюсь фехтованием. У меня такой вопрос. Шест для прыжков очень сильно сгибается. Насколько часто он ломается?
Just to give us a moment as we repeat the question in English.
No, I can translate. The question was how often pole could be broken when you jump in.
So for me, it happens only once in 1998. So that was first and last time. I'm too technical, so too technician.
Sergey, what about you? Has it ever happened?
No, of course, you never predict when pole can be broken. Of course, I had a lot of broken poles in my career, but when it's happening in competition, you have one extra attempt, because this attempt, it's not considered as attempt. The referee can give you one additional attempt. The most important, you need to check and control the pole, that nothing can happen. If you hit upright, the pole in next attempt could be broken. Or someone touch with the spike, because we use the spike and they're very sharp. This is, can be dangerous. But still, anything can happen. And sometimes when it's happened, honestly to say, you in the hands of the God, you cannot manage anything. Because it's happened so quick, so rapid, you lost control, and after when you landed, you come back to reality. And after you can see everything is legs, hands, fine, okay, you go. Maybe in my career it's happened sometime in competition. You must forget everything what's happened. You need to take new pole, and you need to continue to fight. It's not easy. Still, it's certain stress, some risk, you can get scary for sure, but you need to manage, also overcome this condition, just to forget, focus, prepare as usual, and go forward. There's always challenges, and you need to find the key to find solution. But it's pole vault or another event, another sport, anything can happen. But overcome and continue to compete on high level.
Thank you, Sergey. Now, you know, all of us, we are talking about overcoming. We're all talking about overcoming challenges. It all requires hard work and focus. Now, my next question is to Yelena. This is with regard to the incident in Berlin. You know, after the incident in Berlin, you gave an interview, and during that interview, you were actually quoted as saying, "There is so much I can achieve. It took me a defeat to tell me all of this." What role do you think a defeat plays in the life of an athlete?
Well, for me it was a good lesson after Berlin and also after Doha when I lost twice. And when you're on the top, it always seems easy. So for me to win competition, it was not so hard. To break new world record, it was a little bit hard. So I didn't pay such a big value for all the achievements which I've done. And I saw that it will continue forever. And in one moment, I become more relaxing. You know, the sport was maybe in the second position. I start to think about other things during the competition. I said, okay, now I'm... I'm going to win this competition, I will break new world record, then I will get out from the track and I will have fun outside. No? I knew from beginning what's going to happen afterwards. And I was not 100% focused anymore, for my performance, for the competition, for everything. But when I defeat, I was looking at my rivals, which was the new world champion. I was looking at them a little bit from the lower position, and I realized, what it means to be world champions, what it means to be the best, and how it's important to be able to set up new world records and, you know, to remain in the top as long as possible. I realized that they are the best all over the world, so they are the best of the best. So, and I had this position before, so now I lose. And you know, that's give me this understanding maybe. And right now I'm happy that I defeat twice, because I think one time it was not enough. I thought that it's just accident, but after Doha I realized no, probably I have to change something. It can't continue like it is. So and now I'm again, you know, in the feelings of. I'm hungry, I'm again patient for the sport, I want to compete, I want to, how can I say, again prove who I am, I want to bring happiness to all my spectators, to all my fans, which were very disappointed after such a bad competition which I had done. So I again want to be on the top, I want to be the best, and I want to be like a, how can I say, like a captain of the ship, which is women's pole vault, you know. So yeah, I want to be the best again, and I'm so happy that I have these feelings right now, and thanks this defeat, but I will wish to everyone to be a winner, so this is the better.
So indeed, good luck to all of you.
We still have time for more questions. Do we, we have a question, yes. Name, NOC, and sport.
Tiziana Ruiz from Mexico, and I do pole vault. Well, I try. No, I'm not so good. What do you think before and during the competition? Because I always think like, oh, I'm not gonna jump good. I'm always worried about it.
Yeah, don't worry about it. Just try to imagine your best jump in your mind when you had in the training. Just try to make a visual training. Just imagine you run up, your jump before you go into the stadium. And in your mind, you must over the bar all the time. So you put the mark like, you know, for 10, for 20. And if you see it in your mind that you're already over, so it would give you more confidence. And when you're on the track, just be confident. Don't afraid of of bad jump. Don't afraid if you will broke the jump. You would have three attempts anyway. So and every time you would have a chance to adjust something. So just be confident and enjoy everything what happens. So don't worry a lot, because it's what brings you it will. Okay.
Maybe I just want to add the best way, because in any way, and every one of us used stress, you need to survive, because atmosphere, emotion, it's also in this beautiful competition and in youth games. This is first time. But the best way, what I did, I focused on my technical skills. I focus about which high I need to go, what usually I do mistake, how to improve this part of my world. This is will easy. This is release the tension. Because the tension always exists. Just needs to. But if it's too much tension, a little bit sip of water, a little bit. It's always calm you down.
Okay, just to build on your question that you asked earlier, Yelena, you know, we watched the video just now of the 2008 Beijing Olympics. Right before you do your run-up, you are seen to be talking to yourself. So is whatever you just said what that goes through your mind, or is there something else that goes through your mind?
I don't know. it's always in my mind, and you know, when I'm just on a run-up, and when I'm just ready to make a jump, I just think about that I'm gonna over this bar, that now it will be successful jump. So that's what is my mind. But regarding what I'm talking about, it's nothing special. So everyone can find something in themselves which will inspire them, which will give them more confidence. And yeah, it's like this.
Yes, preparation for a run-up, really important. Do we have any other questions from the audience?
The young lady over there. I'm sorry, she put her hand up earlier. We'll come
to
the
next one. Yeah. Once again, name NOC and which sport you play.
Hi, I'm Laura from Chile, and I do mountain bike cross country. And my question is, what do you do when you are disappointed about a result in a competition?
Well, when I defeat in Berlin last year, I was crying 2 days because I can't believe that it happens. And I thought that it was just a bad dream, that next morning I will wake up and nothing happens, but it was reality. So then I will come back to Monte Carlo and my coach gives me just 3 days rest, but completely rest. I went to the sea, I was swimming all day, I was having fun in the scooter, I was all day with scooter, you know, just 90, 80 kilometers, like this, with all this, how can I say, disappointment. I was left there in the sea, in the sea during, during the skating, I don't know how to say. Yes, and then the another day I was just working out, you know, just having fun. I was eating everything I want, I had ice cream, I had a lot of ice cream. No, it brings me happiness. And day by day, I start to forget about this defeat. And I knew that in the front, I mean, in a few, I am a little bit. So soon, I would have another competition where I can prove again that it was just accident, that I'm still on the top and I'm still the best. So and after Berlin, there was a Golden League competition in Zurich, and I set up new world record, which was 5:05. It was just 10 days later, 10 days after the Berlin defeat. So it's just I have empty head, I think, no pressure, and I think of that was thanks my coach, my family, my friends, my management group, to everyone who was support me in such a difficult moment for me. If there will be another situation, if they would push me and say, oh, Yelena, it was impossible, how you can defeat, now the world is kaput, you know, of course I would not survive, but everyone just gives me freedom, and I was doing what I wanted all these days. Then I did some warm-up, and then I did the world record, and I would explain to everyone. So that was the performance in Zurich. It was exactly model what I wanted to make in Berlin, but it was no happen. So, but it was like this.
May I add something? because this question is very good, because also before ask Yelena about defeat. If you never lose, you will never win. You need to go through. This is normal things. The question is what you need to do. You need to analyze, sit together with the coach, analyze what is wrong, where is mistake, to define the situation and continue to work to not repeat the same mistake. In my career, I remember when most difficult things for me, when I lost some competition, come to press conference and start to explain the arguments. I hate this moment. I don't want to find arguments because I lost. I was weak, I didn't prepare well, and I was defeated. Before the competition, I try to remember these bad feelings. And when I have chance, do the best not to be in this situation once again. But also, I have such a motto in my career. Falling down and stand up again, we are growing. And you need to go through, of course, as less as possible. But this is always you can benefit from defeating, to be stronger, to be better, and to be the best.
Okay, do we have another question from the audience? Yes, this gentleman over here, right in front.
Hi, my name is Abel. I'm from Mauritius, and I do pole vault. Just a question about the technique in pole vault. Just to come back to the point when we break a pole. I normally like start to zero, take my step again, because I normally take a harder pole. But I'm always afraid. It takes me about 1 week before maybe just put the pole into the place you need to be to jump. But I just have a question. Does it happen to you to be afraid of it? Or if not, how do you do it? And if yes, what do you do?
Have you been afraid? And what do you do about it?
No, first of all, you're a human being. Of course, you're afraid. And of course, it's for me, it was many stress in competition, even I was the big champion, but still when you come into Olympics, everything is boiling inside. It's always a journalist when they're looking and they tell, oh, Sergey is sleeping, it's 2 hours sleeping and after he start competition, I'm not sleeping, I couldn't sleep. It's no way, because everything is tense inside. But the question how you manage. And when you said when his ball is broken, it's not easy, but I try to switch off this memory because I don't want to lose. If I have still attempt, but for sure I have minimum one attempt more. You try to forget, you try to release the tension, focus again, and continue to jump. It's nothing happen. It's broken, it's fine, it's next one, but try to do it. 1 week is too much. Even you need to do in same competition. But even you, of course it's tough, but in some situation when you are in difficult, because this is very difficult situation when his pole is broken, or sometime you are losing competition and you have only last attempt. In my career, I never jump, if I'm jumping to be the winner, I will not use last attempt to be second or third. I will move to next height. Because next height, I am jumping for victory, for leading position. And this is totally different motivation. It's much stronger than jump for just to survive. Of course, it depends how high is the bar, but for me, it was always important. This is also, you can gain the time to release the tension, analyze everything what's happened, prepare for next world, and go for victory. And most of the time, I manage very well. I won in last attempt, but when it's most difficult situation, I'm stronger. And I overcome higher bar and win the competition. And even sometime, my opponent didn't believe that I able to manage, because it was really not perfect shape, but to win, you need to put a lot of efforts and learn you teach your opponent that they cannot catch you in the corner. You can find solution in any case to overcome problem.
Thank you, Mr. Sergey. Sergey, I have a question to build on that. You were saying that in the run-up, you know, you're very tense, you're concentrating for the jump. It's been said in some interviews that sometimes you seem very unfriendly or very cold to the other competitors because you never talk and you're always looking like, you know, you're angry or something. Does this affect you? What other athletes think of you in your competition?
No, I disagree that I was not friendly with my opponents. I always friendly with them, and I will always correct and respect them because I respect always in my career fair play. But when you go to competition, you focus. You need to do your job. In this way, you not come just to speak with everyone because you're losing concentration when you're speaking to someone. And of course, maybe you took the part when it was in my career in 1997 when I won world championships, because my opponent tried to play with me tricky game. Because he knew certain psychological moments and he wants to shake my hand before competition. But I said to him in friendly way, we can do after. And he tried to place to the press and to present that I'm like arrogant or I didn't respect my opponent. I always respect. And I achieve a lot of performances and a lot of great results thanks to my opponents because they always motivate me. They always push me to be better, to continue to develop my performances. And in this case, I always assist my opponent, help, advise, wherever is takeoff. If need, the poles. I always share my poles because sometimes we travel, pole is broken or didn't arrive right in time because the plane was too small. In this case, if my opponent asks me and my poles, can fit and can be good for them, I always give it to them without any problem. Because I consider the best will be the best. And it was not belong to me to be arrogant to my opponents. And after the competition, it was exactly what I said, 6-0-1. Because this opponent was unfriendly, incorrect to me. And he said before the championships to me that he said in press that Bubka doesn't have courage to stop career. Why he is going to world championships? This is motivate me to win that championships. And of course, he was second, I was the first. On the podium, we shake the hands. No problem.
Of course, one of the very important Olympic values, respecting your opponent, is very, very important.
I consider he didn't respect me before.
So, well, something for all of us here to learn. Do we have another question, perhaps directed specifically to any one of them? The gentleman over there in blue, how about you?
Just hold on. We'll
bring the mic over to you.
Once again, name, NOC, and which sport do you play?
I come from China. My name is Xu Zhengyang, and a question. I have a question. When you finish your competition, and will you spend some time to read a book, or go to university for education, or travel all over the world to get some knowledge? It's okay.
Right. What he's trying to say is, after your competition, do you go about pursuing an education, read a book, take a holiday? You know, what do you do after your competition? Yelena, maybe you want to start first?
Well, after my competition, first I celebrate because, victories, we do celebrate with my coach, with my managers. And yes, of course, I do combine education and sport. And I'm lucky enough because all my teachers from the school and from university always support me. I have my free schedule, so they always give me some information through computer, through email. We always chat in email. And when I get when I have chance to come back to Russia after the competition season, I do exams, I do everything what I have to do. Yes, but I have my own, my personal program. But immediately after competition, I'm not able to read any books or read any lessons because in my mind there is only happiness and, you know, other things to think about, so, but not about the university. But when the few days pass, yes, of course, I have to come back to reality and realize that life is not just sport, but also I must study a little bit also, yeah.
No, I always read when I travel because it's also a good time to use it. And also important to read before competition, not to think about competition, because this is when you're thinking, and you're thinking before competition a lot, how you compete tomorrow, this is dangerous. Better to read something easy, maybe not study, but some easy book, but you focus and go in different way. And of course, I combine education and sport same time. I become world champion in 19 years old in 1983. And same year, I become student of university in my capital. In 87, I am finished, but I retired in year 2000. In 2001, I did my doctorate and I become doctor of pedagogy. It's for sure, this is my good advice for you. Sport and education, you can combine successfully. Because you need to prepare your future. When you retired, all your life in front, and you need to be educated, you need to graduate, you need to have profession, and continue to be successful. But everything should be done right in time. Don't miss the time. Study, plan your future, and you can manage both things together.
That's right, sport and education can be combined. Now, ladies and gentlemen, all of us here are really, really excited. The questions are coming in, but unfortunately, we are racing against the clock, so we only have time for the last few questions. So anybody who still wants to ask a question? Yes, this young lady here.
Hi, I'm Dara Mahfoudi from Tunisia, and I do pole vault.
Too.
You see, the double vault is so beautiful. It's very nice.
Thank you. So my question is, what do you do before the competition? The day before the competition, you prefer to stay in your room and concentrate about the competition, or you do something else to have fun and to forget about it?
Well, once again, the question is, what do these athletes do the day before the competition?
Yes, I always stay in my room. And I concentrate for the competition. And also I do just warm up, the same warm up which I'm gonna do in the day of competition. So, and but in these days, I don't speak to each other. I do not, I don't use computers or no internet at all. And maybe a little bit of TV in the morning time until the lunch time. And yes, I'm completely focus on myself, and I'm just with myself, and I try to just imagine how competition gonna be. I imagine my jump. I always write. I have a book where I write all competition, which pole I use, what mistake I did, how success, how high I jump. I fix everything. And before my next competition, I always read. How was in the past, if it was successful competition, I read it twice or three times just to refresh everything in my memory. If it was bad competition, I try to fix all mistakes which I done, do not repeat it in the day of competition. So, but I just belong to myself in the day of competition, so, yeah.
All right, and Mr. Sergey, do you have any thoughts on that as well? What do you do before your competition? Any form of concentration like what Yelena does?
No, I agree with Yelena. It must be a very peaceful, very quiet day. But as I said before, you can read easy stories because your mind goes somewhere else. Because you has certain pressure and you try to think about competition. But I learn better to think when you're in the field of competition. If you start to jump one day before or 2 days before, you are dead. You will finish competition before you go to the field of competition. In this case, I walk to the park. I walk alone or with my coach. Just calm, easy time. No fun, no stress, no emotion. Preserve all the emotion for the competition. Eat, sleep, watch TV, read the book. Just walk a little bit. Stay with nature. Maybe water, maybe fire. This is give you energy. When you look to the water, and especially when it's stressful time before the competition, when you look on the water, you will get calm. Or if you have opportunities with some, I don't know, fireplace, look to the fire or to the use flame. It's give you energy. And everything will be good next day.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sergey and Ms. Lina. Now, now, of course, we know that these athletes are here for the first ever Youth Olympic Games. They are aged between 14 to 18, and when the two of you started out at a similar age as well. You know, right before we end off today's session, do you have any final words for all our young athletes here as they compete in the Youth Olympic Games?
Lady first.
Okay. The only one thing I could say, just enjoy your stay here in Singapore. Have a fun here. Do your best in your competition. I'm sure that everyone will do your best because that's why you're here. Just to get this opportunity through this culture and education program, build your new friendship, take some knowledge about another country, about other countries, about other nations, about everything. So just enjoy your time here. And when you will return to home, just share all your experience with your friends, with your family, with other young athletes. So because all of you, after this Youth Olympic Games, would become like ambassador of the sport. And from you will depend maybe all other athletes who will asking you about how it was in the Singapore. So you become like ambassador. So take as lot as possible from here, from Singapore, and just share all the knowledge with your colleagues at home. Yeah.
Mr. Bubka, do you have any message you want to tell all these young Olympians?
I will try, but Yelena said really perfectly Now, I just... First, I want to say congratulations, because you are the best. The best, and you are lucky to be in first Youth Olympic Games. In our time with Yelena, we didn't have such a great opportunity. I just want to wish you good, successful competition, because it's great learning experience for you, for your future career. Anything can happen. Just analyze, focus, you win or you lose. But this experience will help you for your future career. Everything in front, this is your beginning. I wish you to achieve the big Olympic podium. For sure, you will never forget this time. You will be great ambassador of Olympism, about sport. Motivate youngsters at home to follow your example, to be really role model, that after a couple years, we will sit, you will sit in this chair and share the knowledge with younger generation. This is, I think, would be great for you. Always share. Do be a great example. Be the champion. Be the best. We trusted you and we believe you will be the very successful.
Very, very inspirational words by our role models, Mr. Sergey Bubka and Ms. Yelena Isinbaeva. I'm sure we've had still a lot of questions coming, but unfortunately, we have to come to an end of the night. We thank you very much, Ms. Yelena Isinbaeva and Mr. Sergey Bubka. Can we give them both a very big round of applause?
Thank you very much, everybody, for being here with us this evening, and we wish you a good night.
Thank you.